So today we're looking at double planets, and our big focus is going to be on the especially rare case of two Earth-sized planets orbiting every 24 hours, since that's probably the most interesting case, to us anyway. But we'll also take a look at a few other examples, including Rocheworlds, double planets that have literally merged into a dumbbell shape, and as always we'll take some time to discuss how native life might arise on such worlds, and what special aspects of terraforming would be needed to make these habitable for humans. The first thing to understand about double planets is that there is no real cutoff at which something ceases being the moon and becomes a double planet. Our own moon, at an 80th of Earth's mass and 1,000 miles in radius, is enormous as natural satellites go, one of the largest in the solar system, and all the others of similar size are around gas giants much bigger than Earth. Yet an Earth-sized moon around a Jupiter-sized gas giant, our topic a couple videos back, would be much more like what we mean by a planet, yet would be proportionally much smaller compared to the gas giant than the moon is to us. Pluto and Charon are the closest to being double planets, and will actually be my own cutoff point. Charon is about an eighth of Pluto's mass, not the 80th the moon is to Earth. Some would argue having the barycenter of the two-body system outside of a larger planet is the proper definition, which is not true for Earth and the moon, but is true for Pluto and Charon, but that's also not my definition for today. I will be arguing that it is because they are both tidally locked to each other that makes for the two being double planets, in this context of what we think of as a habitable planet, which is what the series is about. Now, we discussed tidal locking in detail on the video about that, and before in the series as well, but as a quick reminder, that is when a moon or planets slow its rotation over time from tidal forces until it has the same side always pointing at its larger neighbor. In a double lock, both planets point the same face at each other, and realistically, any two planets of vaguely Earth mass and temperature will be close enough in their orbit of each other that they will have both tidally locked long before complex life could have arisen, though in point of fact, the sheer tidal stresses involved prior to that double lock would probably prevent complex life arising before that lock anyway. What we haven't discussed before is a barycenter, and mostly because it usually doesn't matter. We do not exactly orbit the sun, nor the moon orbit us, in terms of circling around it. For any two-body system, there is a center of mass the two actually orbit, and this moves since the two-body systems usually have at least slightly elliptical orbits. We're mostly interested in a circular or very low eccentricity orbit today, though. Now, if the main body is infinitely bigger than the satellite, the barycenter would be exactly in the middle, but of course that's never the case, and for the Earth-Moon, that barycenter is in Earth's mantle. Whereas for Pluto and Charon, it's actually outside Pluto, and it will be in pretty much any case we'd start thinking of a planet and moon as a double planet instead. As the planets get closer and closer in mass, if you're looking at them from above the barycenter, they increasingly stop looking like one is orbiting the other, and more look like both are orbiting the barycenter, until at equal mass they seem to both orbit on the same circle 180 degrees apart. And if they are both tidally locked, then the same face of each will always point to the other. This is great for space elevators if you've got a material strong enough, because you can run one right from the one to the other. If they're on elliptical orbits, you need to have winches on either end playing out or reeling in a little extra length, since they would alter their total distance a bit. Though you could, hypothetically anyway, use such a tether, if it's just a little stronger than it needs to be, to avoid snapping, to slowly force the two into a perfectly circular orbit, or one just as close to that as you like so as to keep some tidal forces in play, which we'll get back to in a minute. Now, in the case of two planets with approximately the same mass as Earth, the one most people are interested in, once they've gotten tidally locked, in order to have them have a 24-hour day, they need to be just over 33,000 miles, or 53,000 kilometers, from center to center for a circular orbit, only 1/7 the distance from the center to the center of the Moon and the Earth. Different masses or day lengths would have different distances, but you may calculate such cases if you're curious, and in the video description below, there is a link to a convenient online calculator for that. Further away, the days are longer, closer together, and the days are shorter, and we even get more severe tides. Now, that's actually only 25,000 miles apart, since 33,000 was from center to center, and these are 4,000 mile radius planets. That's more than 9 times closer than the moon is, and the planet is just under 4 times wider, so the other planet is going to be about 40 times wider in the sky. Here we've got our moon coming over the horizon, and here would be that double planet. And a double planet could also have a moon, orbiting out far beyond the two, and will more or less look and act like a normal moon of that appropriate size and distance around a planet of double the normal mass. Of course, that double planet never rises or sets. It stays in the same place in the sky, minus minor perturbations and libration like we discussed back in episode 2 in regard to tidal locking. It's also going to be incredibly bright, over 1,000 times as bright as the moon, One side of the planet always has it hanging overhead, and the other never sees it, with a small band around the middle where it wobbles up and down over the horizon. Now, before they came mutually tidally locked, the tides on these planets would be monstrous, but would slow down to very low once that happened, relatively speaking anyway. Two mutually locked bodies still exert tidal force on each other, but it's from the various types of libration and orbital eccentricity, not perfectly circular orbits and the like. A very mildly eccentric orbit that saw the two planets just 5% further apart than when they were closest would mean the gravity between them was 9.3% lower than when they were closest. So the distortion caused by that 24-hour 9.3% drop in force pulling each more together would get you pretty decent tides, considering that the change in force is a good deal stronger than the total force the moon exerts on the Earth. The moon is only about 1.2% of the Earth's mass, so even a twin planet that far away would exert about 80 times more force than the moon does, and ours are 7 times closer. The total force exerted would be around 4,000 times what the moon exerts on us, so the change in force from the moon being on one side, and then another, of the Earth, when compared to a 9.3% variation in force from a planet being 5% closer at perigee than apogee, is a good 200-fold higher. Even if that apogee and perigee ratio was 100 to 101, we'd still be looking at 40 times the force variation. That's vastly smaller than what would have been experienced by both before they tidally locked, but still pretty darn impressive. For Earth-like tides, you need an eccentricity that kept them from moving more than about 100 miles closer or further apart. This is one reason why a space elevator between them, either the classic one built on tensile strength like we discussed in the first episode of the Megastructure series, or the alternative pushing form, the space fountain we discussed in episode 3 of that series, would be very nice for terraforming. Besides the obvious value of a space elevator for getting material on and off those planets when terraforming them, and traveling between them, you could use that elevator to slowly bring the eccentricity to the desired level, which might be preferable to some other methods we discussed in the terraforming video for tinkering with planetary orbits and rotational speeds. Now, a common question about double planets is if they could share an atmosphere, and the answer is yes, but it depends. The Rocheworld case we'll get to in a couple minutes can, but actual double planets like our dual Earth case really cannot. These two planets will actually deform slightly towards each other, making them even a bit closer from surface to surface than I previously mentioned, and there would be an exchange of material during major asteroid strikes, possibly allowing one world to seed the other with life. Especially early on in a solar system's life, when you expect a lot more debris to be careening around and impacting stuff, a strike could send very basic and robust microbes up into orbit to fall back down on the other world. We'd be talking very tiny and robust things though, so you wouldn't expect them to have the same flora and fauna, just to quite probably use the same basic building blocks. And while atmospheres arguably extend hundreds of miles over a planet, what we think of when we mean atmosphere is where you can still breathe and fly, and that could never stretch over that distance. There's no special tricks to terraforming these planets. They are, in this specific case, obviously very Earth-like in mass and temperature, so just that linking space elevator trick is unique to them, and you can actually do something similar with any two bodies, tidally locked or not, so long as you let the base of the elevator move on some track. Though an Earth-Moon one, for instance, would require a lot of extra energy to overcome the constant massive drag of slamming the base through your own atmosphere at supersonic speeds, making this trick much better done from atop an orbital ring, like we also discussed back in the Force Megastructures video, since there's no air up there to cause drag and sonic booms. Regarding life on such a double world, they'd be forming in a very high tide environment, which is not necessarily a concern. Earth used to have way worse tides back when the moon force formed, and it was closer, and the Earth spun around about once every 12 hours, not 24. Only a double planet with any eccentricity is going to keep pretty impressive tides, so possibly amphibians would be a larger share of the planet's animal life. More tides also means more erosion too, and this would affect storms as well. But if you're just thinking of this from a fictional standpoint, or one where we've terraformed it, including altering the orbital eccentricity, then it could be tailored to ape Earth's tides by simply having a low eccentricity. No flying critters between planets though, for that you need a Rocheworld. The Roche limit is as close as an object holding itself together by gravity can get to another larger body before being shredded, as the larger body pulls on the surface of the smaller one harder than the smaller one pulls on that surface itself. This gets worse from both the deformation from gravity and the centrifugal spin near the surface. Equal-sized, or nearly equal-sized, bodies have much lower Roche limits, so close they practically have to be touching. Even our moon, if brought close enough to Earth, would have to be within 6,000 miles, which would be skimming distance since the Earth is 4,000 miles in radius and the moon 1,000, so they'd only have 1,000 miles of separation from closest points. For our double planet, the two can flat out overlap, and Robert L. Forward played with this idea in his novel Rocheworlds. Your two planets are more egg-shaped than spheres, and can definitely share atmospheres. They are also definitely tidally locked. They can share an atmosphere, they can even share an ocean, and eventually they will deform to share land and become a peanut shape. This can take billions of years, but once that occurs, they will begin merging into a single sphere, and that will be a very destructive process if you're living on it. But it is a geological timeline, not a short one. This is also the sort of process that could give birth to a naturally occurring hoop world. We looked at the artificial variety recently in the Megastructure series. While very close double planets should eventually merge together, if this process was interrupted by a strike from a large rogue planetoid, similar to how our own moon is thought to have formed, and a strike that added a lot of new angular momentum to the system, it could result in a torus-shaped planet. Neither a Rocheworld nor a Taurus world are terribly probable or stable items. Double planets, even the big double pair of Earth masses, aren't incredibly likely either, but would be much more likely than either of those. Now, Rocheworld has another problem. The ones with Earth-like gravity would have very short days. These are double planets whose centers, if we're talking Earth-like masses, will only be about 10,000 miles from center to center, so your day length is only 4 hours long. I don't think there's any combination of worlds that would give you a fairly Earth-like gravity and day length that wasn't almost completely water, what we often dub a Panthalassic world. Water deforms, as a fluid, much easier than rigid bodies, so you could have a Rocheworld that had a lot of water and a vaguely same day length and surface gravity, which might actually connect oceans and potentially, if just right, have land masses on the far sides of those two planets. We'll talk more about Panthalassic worlds in the future. Ones who outside this case are worlds with no land mass, or very little land mass, not including icebergs, potentially whole ice continents, and oceans many miles deep. But that's going to wrap us up for double planets today. Next week, we'll be returning to the Fermi Paradox for a new, updated, and expanded version of the comprehensive list of Fermi Paradox solutions, so we can lay the groundwork to start exploring some of those solutions in greater individual depth in their own standalone videos. Questions and comments are welcome. And if you want alerts when those videos come out, make sure to click the subscribe button. In the meantime, try out the other Habitable Planet videos or any of the other video series by clicking on them to bring up that playlist. As always, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.